Would you please stand for the flag salute?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, staff. Not even sure who starts. Jordan?
Jordan Chacon, Administrative Secretary.
Courtney Grisman, Planning Manager.
Megan Hunter, Community Development Director.
Ani Sakino, Senior Deputy City Attorney.
Thomas Weil, Senior Planner.
Thank you. Welcome, staff, commissioners, and public. It's nice to have you here. We will now have a time for general comments. Is there any public members of the public that would like to make a comment? Anthony.
Good afternoon, commissioners. My name is Anthony Rocha, and I serve on the Library and Community Services Commission for the city. I came here today to talk to you guys about something that raised my eyebrows, and is in regards to the conditional use permit for the theaters that never came before the Planning Commission, but somehow was approved by the City Council under administrative reports, I believe. As a commissioner, I've served on the Youth Commission, the Mental Health Commission, the Library and Community Services Commission. I understand that we want to toe the line and, you know, a fine line between advocating for our community but also not angering the people that appointed us. But if there's any time to speak up or to speak out on something, now's the time. I think you should all be contacting your council members and asking them, why was this not brought before the Planning Commission? Why did we not have a say in regards to what our constituencies, you know, wanted in regards to this? You guys are the voice of the community. You guys are supposed to represent, you know, the constituents, and I think it was really kind of shameful that it wasn't brought before you guys. I don't know what's going on, but if there's a time to advocate and stand up for what's right, this is the time. Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Dominic.
How's it going? My name's Dominic Dursa. Today, I was just coming before this commission with a request. There's a few times I actually wanted to come out and see what the Planning Commission was doing, and I noticed that it wasn't meeting due to lack of business. And so my request is, you guys cover some very difficult, complex topics, especially housing. And there's a great need for this to be better understood in the community. And so what I'm asking is that with your experience, with your expertise, on these days that you don't have meetings due to lack of business, use it as an opportunity to better inform the public on these issues. If you speak to Commissioner Lutz, who has a few decades of teaching experience, she'll be able to tell you, when you actually have to teach a subject, you'll find really quick that you learn it that much better, because you have to be able to explain it to people who might not have ever had any experience with it. And so being able to teach a topic, a subject, not only does it build up the community better, because so often people get confused when they hear about things like affordable housing, and they'll come and they'll say, we want more of it. But as you well know, it's not as simple as we want more affordable housing. There are different income levels. There are different ordinances involved. You have to be involved years in advance to sometimes affect this. And so I'm hoping to see in the future that the Planning Commission not have days where they not meet due to lack of business, because certainly part of the business that you should be able to do is educate the public more fully on these issues. Thank you.
Thank you, Dominic. Anyone else interested in coming before the commission? Okay, seeing no one come up, I'm going to close the public comments. Anthony, we'll try to get an answer to you about why that didn't come before the Planning Commission. And Dominic, we certainly will look at the idea of having more study sessions. Good idea. We are now at the consent agenda. Are there any comments from commissioners? Is there a motion? You know, I'm sorry, excuse me, but I just wanted to make sure that, do we have public comment for the consent agenda? Okay, thank you. Okay, so is there a motion and a second?
So moved.
Second.
There's been a motion made and a second. Is there any other comments? Last chance. Okay, we'll have a roll call vote, Jordan.
It's an auction.
Commissioner Anzo?
Here. I'm sorry.
Yes?
Yes, yes.
Yes, sorry. Commissioner Giffen?
Here.
Was that yes that you approve?
Yes.
Yes. Commissioner Griffin?
Aye.
Commissioner Huerta?
Yes.
Commissioner Meeks?
Yes.
And Vice Chairperson Lutz?
Aye. Thank you, Jordan. And I'm going to let you do something else that I skipped right over on the agenda. That's the roll call.
Roll call has been acknowledged. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we'll now move to the public hearing. It's the six-month review of an outdoor market located at 1040 North Main Street, in other words, the Salinas Sports Complex, in the public, semi-public district.
Chair, can I just ask one quick thing? Sorry, so we can move on. I just wanted to clarify that the two items that were brought up earlier in public comment deserve some discussion, and that on our agenda, is the appropriate time to talk about those after the public hearings that we have scheduled in terms of future consideration? Is that when we should talk about that?
I'm going to ask Anise to answer that, because I agree with you. They were important.
We can certainly follow up during future agenda items. It sounded as though Vice Chair Lutz has asked staff to provide answers to those public comment inquiries, and that we can certainly make sure that the commission is also brought in the loop on those answers as well.
And okay, I think good. I did ask for staff to respond, but let's also have
let's talk about that a little bit.
Commissioners weigh in. So let's do that during the future agenda items.
Thank you, Chair. Okay.
Thank you. Thomas, you are on.
Thank you very much, Commissioner Lutz, commissioners. The proposal is for a six-month review of a previously approved outdoor market located at the Salinas Sports Complex. I think so. Okay, the recommendation is to for the Planning Commission to continue the approve the revised resolution for the allowing for the continued operation of an outdoor market located at the sports complex. The background is that the applicant was El Mercado Popular Incorporated, which operates other outdoor markets in such areas such as Santa Cruz and Watsonville, in conjunction with the California Rodeo Association, which operates the facility. The site is owned by the City of Salinas. It's for a family-friendly event to allow for local farmers, food vendors, nonprofits, and this for the sale of new and used and new item vendors to sell those products. The facility is zoned public and semi-public. Adjacent uses include commercial, such as the Sherwood Gardens Shopping Center, public semi-public, religious assembly, and residential. The property is owned by the City of Salinas and is leased to the California Rodeo Association. A similar proposal was denied by the city back in 2011. Back on April the 4th, 2017, the City Council approved resolution number 2-1144, which approved for the outdoor market the Salinas Rodeo grounds for Wednesdays only on a 6 month trial period with free off-street parking, hours of operations 4 to 8, with vendor setup from 2 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. is located on the westerly portion of the Salinas Sports Complex between the grandstand and the box office. The market started operation back on April the 26th, 2017, and the resolution requires Planning Commission review of the outdoor market, which was a requirement of the resolution that the Planning Commission review the operations of the outdoor market no sooner than 5 months from the first initiation of the first market, which was on April the 26th. The notice was sent to the public, and no public concerns have been received as of yet, or at the time the staff report was done for the project. The outdoor and the outdoor market was permitted to operate 27 times over a six-month period on Wednesdays. All other provisions of an earlier resolution, 182.80, remained in full force and effect. Per the zoning code, a minimum of 110 off-street parking spaces, including five accessible spaces, are required. A maximum of 90 vendors are allowed for the outdoor market. The outdoor market customers utilize a 450-space off-street parking lot, which is located adjacent to the north of the market site, which allows for the minimized parking impacts to the surrounding neighborhood. Per the applicant, on April 26th, they started out with 70 vendors, 180 vehicles, and 553 people. By September 27, 2017, it had gone to 87 vendors, 334 vehicles, and 1,339 persons. There are three security guards that help to direct traffic and parking, and seven other staff members to help provide for operations at the outdoor market. The applicant is looking at requesting a change to the operating hours, such as making it earlier to allow in the fall and the winter to allow for customers to access the site prior to sunset, and also looking at the possibility of extending operations to Sundays as well. Any changes to the actual resolution as far as in terms of amendments to it to allow for changing operating hours and for extending the operation of Sundays would require a City Council consideration. And since this was actually allowed for a six-month trial period, the applicant will be required within 6 months of the Planning Commission consideration of the outdoor market to request a public hearing in front of the Planning Commission for any changes such as an amendment. Staff visited the outdoor market twice in late October 2017. The market showed to have a variety of goods being offered for sale. And also that the one thing is that the applicant needs to improve pedestrian and vehicle access. We did notice some of the outdoor gates were locked, and so we need just to provide adequate emergency access for exiting the site in case of an emergency. And also staff would need a clarification of the midway area because it is expanding north, as seen with the photo, kind of north of the grandstand area. And so we just need the verification that that is an acceptable area for the outdoor market to operate. In conclusion, the outdoor market was found previously exempt from the California Environmental Quality Act by the City Council back in April per Section 15304E, minor alterations of land. There was adequate public notice. Public notices were posted on October 14th on-site at City Hall. And at the Permit Center, it was also mailed to all property owners and interested parties on that same date and published in the Salinas, California on October 6th. Staff recommends that the Planning Commission approve the revised resolution with changes to condition BB to allow for fire department inspection and licensing for operation to allow the continued operation outdoor market on Wednesdays at the Salinas Sports Complex. Is there any questions of staff at this time?
Is there any questions from the commission, commissioners? Okay.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you for the update. So, can you remind me in terms of any cost to the city? Are there
costs
to the city that assist facilitate
operations? I'm not aware of any. I'd like kind of to see if the Salinas Rodeo Association, because they're here to answer, but I'm not aware if there's any specific impacts to the.
Any additional police or anything else that's allocated to the.
They do have security, but I haven't.
They have seen, security.
Yeah, they have security on site. So.
Private security.
Private security. 3C, yeah. One.
Can you remind me what the fee is to enter?
There's no fee to park, but it's a $2 fee.
$2. $2?
Yeah.
Hey, you'd be surprised if anybody sees it. Why not free then? It's just $2.
Yeah,
I do want to put that out there for the hour. But a quick question, too. You mentioned that at least twice there has been some participation by the city to explain it to me. did the city participate in terms of a booth and engagement at this, at the market, or just kind of go to check it out?
We just went to check it out. I went by myself on the 20th, and me and Lorenzo Sanchez, and the co-enforcement, went on site, and we took a look at it. And that's the photos that we have in the staff packet.
The booths are free, right? If someone had a...
Like for public service? Or
yeah, for public service.
I believe they are, but that needs to be confirmed. I believe that that's, that is something that was provided, but I'd like to defer that to them.
Got it. I appreciate that. But I don't know if you know, in terms of whether the city had planned or should be participating in terms of staffing with Parks and Rec or somebody out there to make sure that their outreach in terms of the programming for the city at this fairly public affair. Just curious.
Yeah, I'm not aware of any of that. I know that there are some like Covered California and a couple other nonprofits that are out there.
Resource
but,
area.
Yeah.
Okay. And then quick question, because it's always helpful to know in terms of, you know, it seemed like things picked up in terms of the two or three sessions that you guys have looked at in terms of the people attending and all that. Is there any data or information in terms of surveys or feedback from people participating?
I'm not aware of any, but I'd like to defer to the Rodeo Association and to the applicant, but as far as any feedback on any polling on that.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Any other questions? John?
I have a question. It might be for the applicant themselves, but the pictures that are attached to this show some live birds and stuff and a snake. Do you make sure that there's a health certificate for these live animals, or are they still selling them?
Well, they're still selling them. They're required to get licensing or all applicable licensing, and I'd also like to defer that, you know, as far as the licensing to the applicant and to the Rodeo Association, but they're required to get licensing for the selling of pets.
Thank you.
I have a quick question. Tom, the vehicle and pedestrian access improvements that you're requiring, when will those be done? I mean, is there a timeline?
Well, they should be done probably immediately, because the main thing is that when we were there, some of the gates were locked. It's an outdoor operation, but there was one main entrance where pay, and then a couple of the other gates were locked. And so there is the requirement that they maintain.
Which will happen right away.
Yeah.
Okay, good. Any other questions? Yes.
I would like to go back in time. This situation occurred back in 2003. My first question that came to mind to me is number one, insofar as, is the applicant here?
Yeah,
the applicant. Would you please stand so I can recognize whom you may be?
Yes.
Would you identify yourself, please?
Yes, my name is Patricia Rodriguez. Come up here.
Hello, Patricia Rodriguez.
And your position with the organization you're representing?
I am the owner, co-owner with my husband.
And you own what?
The business is a corporation.
And is your corporation called El Mercado Popular Inc.?
Yes, it is.
Excuse me, Commissioner.
I'm asking some questions because I don't have the background.
No, I understand. Okay. I understand. I just, this was a time for asking staff questions. And
well, I thought you said it was for the board.
To ask staff.
No, staff is fine. I'm concerned about
good.
What's
okay.
on.
Okay, so let me just quickly finish up. If there's no more questions for staff, then I'm going to turn it over to the applicant.
Okay, so that's where I thought we were.
And, you know, I'm just going to ask you may want to make a statement before you answer questions. So if you want to make a statement, this is your chance. And then you'll take questions from the commissioners.
Yes, I would just like to, thank the Planning Commission and City Council for allowing us the opportunity to have this event happening here in Salinas. We have three other events like this that are twice as big in, Monterey, Santa Cruz, and Santa Clara counties. And we are very happy to see that this is a place where families can come for recreation. It's a safe and just family-oriented event. And I felt that, Salinas could also benefit, from our event, and that's what I see happening. You know, so far we haven't had any problems or issues. That's why ahead of time, you know, we prepare with, you know, having security on site where, you know, most other markets don't. And I feel that, you know, we are responsible and we're doing, you know, a good job, and we would like, you know, to have, you know, your permission to continue.
Okay, thank you. Questions, and I'm just going to go right to you. Finish your questions.
Okay, let's get back between yes. you and I. I noticed that you are in two or three other counties within this geographic area as a company.
Yes.
What type of a contract did you negotiate between you and the Rodeo Association? And the reason I ask this uh-huh. is this is city property that they in turn have an agreement, I believe, with the city of Salinas. And so what came in mind for you to approach the association and set up the operation which you now have and are operating?
Okay, well, let me make sure I understand your question. You want to know why I decided to open this type of business at the Rodeo?
What prompted you and who encouraged you?
Well, what prompted me is that we have a similar business, you know, the same business in Watsonville, and most of our vendors are coming from Salinas and also our customers. So then, you know, because of that, both customers and vendors would say, you know, why don't you open something like this in our community so we don't have to drive to Watsonville to do this? So that's what, you know, prompted me to do it. And, when, you know, looking at the city, I felt that the Rodeo would have, you know, what we needed to have this type of event.
In operating your business, do you have any kind of a monetary outlay to any organization, such as do you pay any gratis to the Rodeo Association?
Yes, I pay a fee, a rental fee, every time we're there.
In addition to that rental fee, you then charge the vendors a fee?
Yes, we charge the vendors a fee and we charge customers a fee.
Okay, the customer's fee is to attend, correct?
Yes, correct.
All right. And so your end of the bargain is you will provide security, which you have, your people, parking cars, and yes. so on and so forth.
Yes.
And you collect monetary parking fees from the public to
yes.
park, in addition to the vendors.
Yes, that's correct.
But the city gets nothing.
Not that I know of. I mean, I just pay the Rodeo, and from that, I don't know what happens to, you know, the money that goes to the Rodeo.
I think, Commissioner, that we have a comment from staff to follow up on your question.
Yeah, so as far as I know, you do not charge fees for parking.
No, there's no fee for parking. Sorry.
It's just for the...
parking fee.
It's just for the walk-ins?
It's
is that what you're saying?
It's just for the walk-ins.
And those getting out of their cars to go in.
Yes, just for people going and coming in. We decided to do that so there wouldn't be an issue with people trying to park in the residential area or, you know, across the street to avoid paying the fee.
Okay. I have another question. Perhaps it doesn't attain to you, but I believe it goes back to you, Tom. Okay. Under the analysis portion that you provided for us, I have questions.
Yeah, no, I know, but I know that the protocol is questions for staff, then questions for the applicant, and then we can reopen it for staff. And so just to allow if there are any other commissioners, so we avoid the sort of coming up and back. I think it's better that way.
Let me ask you this. Are we not talking about the same subject?
Commissioner, I think what we're trying to do is open it up now for just questions to the applicant. Then I will come back and we'll allow questions again of staff.
Let me ask you this. In the future, can you propose an agenda of how you want to go down the list and start saying, okay, we want to go A, B, C, and D? Because what you have is you give us this material, okay? We go down, we study it, we make notations, and we follow the material given to us by staff.
Right.
And so I'm only going by staff that because I have the floor I have these questions and I'm trying to get some answers, and all of a sudden I'm being chastised. You can't do this because we do it this way.
No, I you're not being chastised, but what it is I had opened up for questions to staff, at which time you wanted to talk to the applicant, which is fine. We closed then the time for staff comments, and now we're moving to the applicant's comments or questions. I will be happy to come back to staff, but let me just make sure that everybody up here has a chance to ask the applicant their questions as long as she's here. And then we'll come right back to you and let you ask staff questions again.
Proceed.
Okay. All right. Are there any other questions from the commissioners for the applicant? No? Yes? Oh.
Chair.
Turn around.
I have a question. Thank you. Would you be opposed to having some kind of requirement? We don't have to define exactly what it is, but of an ongoing, small, quick survey at your weekly events, so that we can get a better sense of who's attending, what they care about. Maybe there's some city outreach efforts.
No, not at all. I would be happy to do that.
So you're open to having
yes.
Kind of a community ongoing community survey at this private but publicly supported event.
Yes, you know, we also, you know, have an area for nonprofits or, you know, community organizations who would like to come out there.
Appreciate that. And I understand that those booths are free of charge?
Yes, those are free of charge.
Great. Thank you very much.
Any other questions for the applicant? Okay. So while the applicant's still here, and we're going to get to you, Commissioner Griffin, in just a minute, I would like to open for public comment or questions for the applicant at this point. If the public has any questions, comments, please come up and speak. Anthony, I can't tell if you're coming to get, okay. Okay, then seeing no movement, I am going to close the public comment. I'm going to bring it back to staff, and staff, we have a few more questions. Commissioner Griffin?
Thank you. Okay, Tom, this is going to be pretty well, I'm going into the background, not having previously been there before. All this is new. Mm-hmm. I'm only looking for clarification. And then to be on the same page as you are. So that's where I'm coming from.
Okay.
Okay, we go in and we talk about this 18280 resolution passed by the city council. And it indicated back in 2003 that they were gonna allocate 5 days a year for this gathering.
For farmers markets.
Right, okay, that's what you specify in here. My question at this point, could you recall or do you know any reason why it was only put at 5 and maybe not more or less?
I think that primarily matches what the zoning code would allow that at that time for a specific site. And so the change to the request at that time, because actually a copy of the resolution is a part of the Planning Commission's staff packet. And when it was approved back in 2003, I think it was 5 was to pretty much help make it consistent with the zoning code at that time.
That's correct. Okay. And I understand that. But my next question would be then, why was it requested that we increase that number from 5 to 27. What prompted that change and for what reason?
Well, the change was requested to allow for the farmers market, because the problem is that we could not allow a farmers market at the Rodeo Grounds as per this resolution for only 5 days. So the new resolution, which was approved earlier this year by the City Council, extended that to 27 to allow for the applicant to have outdoor markets on Wednesdays.
Okay, because in your report on page 3 of 6, there's no time element, as you just indicated, as why you 5 was insufficient and we went to 27. See, so that's where the question came up in my mind, and that's why I asked, okay? So going on down, we then allocated 27 times all on Wednesdays. Where is the rest of this so-called resolution 18280? Because the only reference that I see predicated on the information you have provided for us is only that we have a five-day period over that time frame. I could not find in my notes anything about the balance of 18280.
Actually the resolution? Yeah, there's a copy of it. Were able to get a copy? Because this was part of the packet. And the resolution that was approved by the council in April only affected farmers markets, outdoor markets, everything else in 18280. The earlier resolution remains full force in effect.
Well, see, that staff report that I got, I didn't get the rest of that resolution, and that's why I inquired about it.
But so it was just primarily to modify, to amend this new resolution to allow for increased outdoor markets to provide for the applicant to have their outdoor markets on Wednesdays and to increase the number to allow for that to occur.
Okay, we'll move on then from there. Okay, we'll move over to the occupation of the outdoor market, page 4 of 6.
Mm-hmm.
And it says here, the attendance, traffic, who's in charge. You give us a count on the vendors, number of vehicles and persons attending, and you let us know who's operating, which the applicant is providing the staff members or the security and directing traffic there at the site, okay? And there's no charge to the city for any of these services, correct? That they're providing for us or the flow over at the marketplace?
Well, the parking is free, and you know the thing is that they do have a entrance charge, and I believe that they have an agreement with the Rodeo Association, because they're working with that as far as sales tax or anything, you know, any financials on that. I would need once again to defer to the Rodeo Association and to the applicant of any sort of financial as far as, you know, for sales tax, etc. But the one reason why we had free parking required it was because back in 2011, many members of the neighborhood, as well as the Sherwood Gardens Shopping Center, became very concerned that if you charged for parking, people would instead go across the street and park there. And so to address their concerns, we required that this outdoor market have free parking, and they do have a minimal entrance charge.
Now, one thing I noticed way back in 2011, this came before the Planning Commission and was rejected.
Mm-hmm.
Is that right?
I didn't need to check, but I think there was some concerns with it.
Right, and in reviewing the rejection, we're back in square one again. This organization wants to move this not only from Wednesday, but back to Sundays. Now we got our people across the street in the Sherwood, the shopping center, and so forth. We got the same conflict and complaint that occurred in 2011. Overlooked completely here. The question is why?
Well, they're looking, first of all, if it was Sunday, because they'd like to increase their business. As far as parking, I think one of the main concerns is that if they charge for parking on at the site, people would go across the street to the shopping center. And as far as the request, that request would have to go to the city council. Now, as far as as keeping the determination of having free parking, which would be a major concern because that would possibly put vehicles in the neighborhood and across the street, that may be requested as a part of any future amendment if they do come in for an amendment to change it to extend the services as well as Sunday.
Well, I foresee, number one, the volume of a population of Salinas has increased vastly since 2011. The traffic has increased 2011 and are going past this area, okay? So now we got a larger traffic problem. Most of these people work 6 days a week, so Sunday's their day off. That's gonna be a zoo out there. And maybe that's why back in 2011, the Planning Commission at that time, for that reason, said, sorry, but we gotta pass.
Excuse me, Commissioner Griffin, I think that Megan has a response also.
Wonderful. Go right ahead, Megan. I'm listening.
Yeah, so I did want to correct what I understand is actually that the Planning Commission approved it. It was actually at City Council in 2011, and if it's not stating that in the staff report, because the Planning Commission actually came up with the conditions that were presented to the City Council for consideration. And at the time, it's my understanding from talking to some City Council members that were there, that one of the major reasons why it didn't get approved was because of the concern about Sunday business and the impact to businesses, particularly in the Alisal, which is the primary day that people shop in that area. And so they didn't want to create a competitive situation. At the time that there was a public hearing at the City Council, there were a number of businesses that came in from the LSL that expressed frustration or not non-support. And at the time, SUBA took a position, I believe, not to support the outdoor market. Since then, that has changed. The applicant did actually reach out to SUBA, which is the business association in the LSL. And I think as it currently operates on Wednesday evenings, they are supporting it. We're looking at just the continuation of the market. Any change to hours the day to go to Sunday would have to go to the City Planning Commission. Certainly, you can, state how, as a Planning Commission, how you feel, but your action today is actually just looking at whether or not they're meeting the conditions outlined in the attachment. So I just wanted to clarify that.
However, this impacts what's going on today because they're asking for Sunday, didn't specify quite what hours, okay? So there will be a problem down the road. And it will reflect back to 2011, which was in the report that said, we're not gonna allow this to take place, okay? And we're just going the opposite direction, and what happened in 2011 doesn't matter. We're at 2017 with an entirely larger population, more people. And my feeling is that when you're looking here at a marketplace and you got all of these different types of businesses there that really don't fall into the access of a flea market for farmers, for food, and everything it started out to be, this is a shopping center. That's it. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Yeah, and I just... I appreciate it, and I think if you wanted us to put something to send to the City Council regarding an expansion of the time, that would be fine, but the action before you is really a review of the conditions and determination if under these conditions with the one added fire condition, if they can kind of continue their operations. And within the next 6 months, they do have to go back to the City Council, even to continue beyond that 6 month time frame, and at which time they would go to the City Council to talk about different hours.
But one thing else, they're asking to further extend their selling grounds. They want to move on to the grassy area in there, so they're going to take more space, more vendors. Okay? That's their goal. And it's right here in the report. That should also be mentioned.
Okay, are there any other questions for staff, quickly wrapping this up?
I don't have a question, but I just want to confirm that what Megan said was true. In 2011, we did approve it.
Thank you. Okay, how about comments from commissioners? And at this point, Mr. Griffin, you might want to recommend hours for Sundays. Otherwise, any other commissioners want to make a comment at this point?
Just a quick question on the hours comment, though. I mean, that would be if... I guess that would be a recommendation for a future action item, right?
Right.
I mean, because right now what we're trying to say is, and I appreciate staff's report when they say, okay, the issue is, does the Planning Commission have any comments or recommendations with regard to the continued operation of this outdoor market that we've just heard staff and the applicant explain thoroughly how that's been performing at the Salinas Sports Complex? My quick comment on that is, it sounds like it's going well. Unfortunately, I've had Wednesday commitments, so I haven't been able to check it out. But from what I can hear from others, what I see on Facebook, and from what I hear from staff, that it's been fairly well enough attended. I would be concerned in terms of, you know, is there a good enough attendance? You know, I heard the applicants say that it's much smaller than the other venues. So I would be concerned as to the ongoing sustainability of this. That hasn't come up yet. I would expect the applicant would be concerned about that. I don't see that. I haven't heard anything negative coming from it. I would have expected SUBA to at least write a letter of some kind, not a recommendation, so someone can read into that. But to have such a very strong opposition at one point and then to not say anything at this point, to me speaks volumes that at least given where we're at, there's support for it to continue, and that at the current level, and that if that were to, it sounds like we're okay with that, or the community is okay with that, but if it were to increase to the level of or if the proposal on the table were to increase the level of activity there significantly, then it's a whole new ball game. We'll have to have those conversations again, hear from the community, SUBA, others, and take appropriate action. I, for one, think that it's along the same track here. I think, though, that it might be important to just add a little bit, something different between now and the next 6 months that gives us a little bit more information. And so, and the reason why I was asking the questions about the city participating is because the city, and me having gone to some of the parks and rec activities that the city has helped put on, whether it's Natividad, you know, the various activities, different parks, one of the main benefits, right, is getting information back from the public and feeding that into our plans and our processes and our priorities, our funding priorities. We don't really have that here, right, where we've kind of said, okay, hey, it's a private thing if they work it out and have a good time. Well, but it's kind of, it's quasi, right, because it's a public resource, and we're essentially renting that out and empowering somebody else to kind of take care of that, but we should, as a public entity, be concerned about, okay, are we doing this the right way? How is it really working out? I think we need more information. So without doing a huge amount of work on it, can we ask the applicant, I'd like to actually request that we ask them to do just a very quick survey, and it can be an online thing, and as people come through, please fill this out, get at least 5% of people to fill it out. That would be a goal, not a requirement, a goal, and three questions. You know, what do you like best about the farmer's market here? Is there anything you want to improve? And something else that somebody smarter can come up with in terms of what the city wants to see done, right? So I just want to put that out there as food for thought, see what other commissioners think, and then if no one else wants to, I could make a motion, but I'd like to hear what other people think.
Other comments?
My only comment is before we can do anything with this resolution, we need to know what the number is. It says 2017-blank. Well, how can we approve it before we know what it is?
got a good answer for that one. If it doesn't get approved, it doesn't get a number.
George, do you have any comments?
No.
Okay. And did you want to follow up on anything? Or was that, no, Jeff?
No, I've got the egg on my face, so I'm fine.
Jill, I got one other question. Sure. Do these vendors, number one, have a city license to operate in the city of Salinas? And if not, why not? And if they're not licensed, that means that the city is not getting paid the fees that they're charging other vendors throughout the city. So the question is code enforcement going to be working to look into this, to find out, are all these vendors that we got so many now, have they got a license from Salinas? Not from your organization, from the city of Salinas, because they're operating on our property, and we have ordinances out there that indicates that you need to get a permit to sell in Salinas.
Okay, good question.
Yes, I can answer that. Before opening my first market, I talked to all the different departments, you know, city, county, state, and all of my vendors have all of the necessary permits. For example, all of the vendors have a seller's permit, and they pay taxes to the state. The city decided that I would pay for the business license for the event. So I pay a business license that includes all of the vendors.
Is that a license or a plural license for all those vendors?
Well, what the city has is they have an option. You know, there's certain, you know, I don't know who decides, but there's, in you know, one case, each vendor pays for their license. But in this case, they wanted to make sure that everyone was paid for. So, and, you know, the license that I pay, it includes everybody. So it's a license for an event of this size and for that includes all of the vendors.
Hearing your remarks, my question would then be, what's the dollar amount versus A1 individuals versus this umbrella?
Yeah, so I would just state that this is something that the finance department stipulates that they did retain a business license as was required by the finance department. They do have this for other entities. They have for a lot of special events and things like that, they do. And for farmers markets, this is a common thing that they have established to allow for vendors who may, this may be their only you know, event that they do. And many of the vendors actually have a business license on their own as individuals, but to ensure and to make it to make sure we are making sure everything is operated appropriately, the applicant is actually the holder of that business license. And that's how finance directed us to handle it.
But I still requested a dollar amount, large or small.
I don't know that that's relevant to this action today. We can only say that they have conditions, but the contracts that the applicant and, you know, the rodeo and the city and so forth, those financial relationships aren't part of what we're reviewing today.
And when we started, I asked all of the vendors to go and get a, you know, business city, the license, and they all went in and they were told, no, you know, you're not going to pay for it. The organizer is going to pay for it. So that's something that the finance department decided, not us. You know, on our part, we wanted to send everyone in to pay for it, but they were told, you know, that that's not the way it was going to work. So that's not, you know, something that we decided.
Okay.
We all, you know, they also have, you know, all the food vendors have a health department permit. We get inspected by the health department, by the fire department, the state. And when you went, someone asked about the animals, or, you know, when animals are sold, they can only be sold by someone who has a state license and who has a pet shop. So the person we have there has a pet shop and has all, you know, has the proper licenses.
Thank you.
Yeah, but we're talking about Salinas, not the state. Okay, that's one thing. The other thing is your operation has continued to blossom, and you're getting many, many more vendors. And this is what my concern is, that I don't think the city of Salinas is getting its financial retribution.
Can I answer something? We're not getting more vendors. We are following the amount that we were allowed. So we're not expanding the number of vendors.
Well, you haven't reached your match yet based on what they asked you, so you got room for more vendors.
Well, you know, of course, but it's only going to be based to the limit that they allowed us to have. And the reason we have some vendors in the grass area, you know, this was to accommodate disabled people that want to come out and that they can't offload their vehicles, and, you know, they have large things that are heavy. So that's the reason we're using the grass area. But it's not, you know, we're not exceeding the number that we were allowed.
Thank you. And I think that question then was answered regarding, it was our finance department that made that decision. Matt, question.
Yeah, and actually, I do actually really appreciate Commissioners Griffin's line of questioning on
Giffen?
Giffen.
Commissioner sorry. Giffen.
Excuse me. Conniferating. You know, say potato, potato, right? Sorry. Excuse me. Giffen. Excuse me. Giffen. Quick question on that, and maybe staff has this, is, so the up to amount, though, so up, it's up to 90 vendors. Whether you have 50 or 87 or 90 is up to the applicant, correct?
Well, the maximum they can have is 90. So.
Correct. Do they pay 90? So the quick question is, do they pay for 90 vendor? Does their permit pay for, it pays for 90 vendors no matter what? That's the fee you pay. Thank you. That's all. That was my quick question.
Thank you. So if there are no more questions, I'm looking for a motion.
I'd like to make a motion.
Go.
I'd like to make a motion that the Planning Commission affirm the findings set forth in the attached resolution and allow continued operations of the outdoor market at Salinas Sports Complex with one modification, that the applicant include a minor community survey so that we get more information as to how the market is performing.
And I just want to make sure that this is the updated resolution that you're referring to.
Yes, Chair. Is that motion sufficient?
I think so. I just wanted to confirm, because this is typically a little bit a condition that's a little bit outside of our typical planning commission. I just wanted to make sure you're okay for voluntarily doing that survey per the request before we take a, okay, thank you.
Okay, we have a motion, we have
second. The motion.
Okay, a motion's been made, second. Any further comments? Then Jordan, the roll, please.
Commissioner Anzo?
Yes.
Commissioner Giffen?
Abstain.
Commissioner Griffin?
Aye.
Commissioner Huerta?
Yes.
Commissioner Meeks?
Yes.
And Vice Chairperson Lutz?
Aye. Thank you. The motion passes. Moving on to the next piece of business consideration, preliminary project review, a request to establish and operate a warehousing and storage limited mini storage in the Gateway Overlay District. And Thomas, you're on again.
Thank you very much, Commissioner Lutz, commissioners. The proposal is...
Tom, I just wanted to acknowledge that the technician is wanting us to talk into our microphones and make sure that they're on, so... She keeps coming out with signs to indicate that.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Proposal is preliminary project review 2017-02. It's a request to establish and operate warehousing and storage limited, which is many storage uses in the Sanborn at US 101 Gateway Overlay District. The recommendation is that the Planning Commission provide direction to the applicant regarding amending the zoning code to allow for mini storage uses located on industrially zoned properties in the Sanborn Road at US 101 Gateway Overlay, subject to the conditional use permit process. The background is that the Brad Slama is the applicant, owns a property at 851 Work Street, and thanks. He is looking at proposing a warehousing and storage or mini storage site. It's currently a vacant site. It's zoned industrial general at the Sanborn at US 101 Gateway Overlay. It's located also in the airport overlay and in a flood overlay district, being next to a reclamation ditch. It's constructing would be other similar uses within the city of Salinas for the IG district. Per zoning, so the zoning code, the mini storages may be considered in the industrial general district through this conditional use permit process, which is discretionary, and may either be approved administratively by the planning manager or, in this case, would be required by the planning commission through a public hearing. However, this site is located in the Gateway Overlay District, and per the zoning code, these mini storage uses are not allowed in a Gateway Overlay District on industrially zoned properties. The next slide shows the general plan and zoning maps for the city. And get the next slide, please. Thanks. The purple areas, mainly in the southern part of the city and on the western parkland, West Market Street, are primarily the vast majority of the industrially zoned properties are located, and both on the general plan and the zoning map. And the area, actually Work Street, is located more in the south-south-east portion of the community. Well, the next slide shows the general plan and zoning gateway maps for the community. It next. In on the left is the general plan gateway map, gateway overlay zones for the general plan, and on the right shows the gateway overlay districts for the zoning code. And they pretty much the property is located in the on the Sanborn at US 101 overlay, which is near the airport, and this would be where the proposed activity would occur. The next slide is an analysis of the as I said, it's the applicant is requesting a preliminary project review before the Planning Commission. It's mainly to gauge the Commission's support for a possible future zoning code amendment to authorize mini storage uses located within the Gateway Overlay District and that are zoned industrial general through the conditional use permit process, which is stated as discretionary. The preliminary project review is primarily provides a process to allow the applicant and the city to acquaint themselves with the procedures, regulations, standards that be required, and identify potential development and environmental issues that would be associated with any proposed conceptual development project, or in this case, any considering any zoning code amendment. It's not a formal project. It's also intended to primarily assist the applicant and the city in review of any conceptual development plans, or in this case, and any changes to the zoning code amendment or amend the zoning code amendment. Excuse me, to amend the zoning code. No public hearing or notice is allowed or to be provided for a preliminary project review. The Planning Commission mainly is, the duties are primarily, per the zoning code, is to discuss the proposal with the applicant, provide preliminary comments in regard to the proposal for the future zoning code amendment, and no approval or denial is provided. And the staff recommends that if the commission is supportive of the concept of allowing mini storage uses in industrial general districts in the focus growth overlay with a conditional use permit, that they also look at possibly over amending the overlay district to allow them with a conditional use permit in the IGC industrial general commercial to match the zoning code requirements. It also allows for mini storage through the conditional use permit process. It would allow mini storage projects to be considered on a case-by-case basis and subject to conditions that would address potentially negative effects on the on the neighborhood, on adjacent neighborhoods. Staff suggests that the overlay district boundaries remain unchanged, and the applicant is not requesting to change any of the boundaries, nor any changes to the existing approval process of the mini storage approval, which does require, as per the zoning code, an affirmative vote of five planning commissioners. If four vote for approval, it automatically goes to the City Council for final consideration. Therefore, in conclusion, for the next slide, is that the purpose of the preliminary project review is to gauge Commission's support for possible future zoning code amendment to allow for mini storage on industrially zoned properties located within the Gateway Overlay District through the conditional use permit process. And staff recommends that the Commission provide direction to the applicant concerning any proposed future changes to the zoning code. Is there any questions of the Commission?
Thank you, Thomas. Actually, I'm going to turn it over to Megan.
Yeah, and I just wanted to explain, this is a little bit different than in the mini storage you kind of reviewed before. What the applicant is proposing is a zoning code amendment. That's why we don't have kind of the level of detail that you were looking at before. Mini storages are allowed in the zone, the IG district, today, but this one, because it's in a gateway, it is not allowed. They are proposing that it would be subject, that the amendment would be, they still would have to get a conditional use permit. It would still have to achieve the supermajority threshold of the Planning Commission to move forward, but it wouldn't be a non-permitted use as it is currently. So that would be the amendment, and I think what the applicant explained, and he's here and he could tell you more, but this allows the use of sometimes difficult sites to develop, but they still could meet development design and development standards that a gateway, as a gateway, you want to have a higher level of development standards because you're presenting kind of the entrance, right, to the city. So that's kind of the consideration. He's looking for guidance because pursuing a code amendment, there's a cost associated. So as we had last time, they did pay for a preliminary review to kind of gauge, get the guidance or direction from the Planning Commission, and depending on that would determine whether or not to pursue it further. So I just wanted to clarify that this is a little different than the last meeting. You're really considering the code amendment. He did also want to inquire about the gateway, the modification to the gateway, but for us as staff, we're not recommending changing those boundaries because those were kind of developed through a very extensive community engagement process, through general plan process, and we think that probably any modifications to gateway boundaries belongs through the general plan update process, which we hope to start in summer of 2018.
Thank you, Megan. So the process is going to be, we'll open it for questions from the commission to staff, and then we'll have, if the applicant's willing to come up and make a statement and answer questions from the commissioners, we will then close and open public comment for any questions from the public, and then come back to the commission to provide direction to the applicant. So, any questions for staff?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, Tom. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Chair. A couple quick questions. Are you aware of any kind of alternative site analysis that the applicant may have already conducted? I mean, is this the only site they're looking at? Are there other things? Has that come up in conversation?
Well, he's looked, I believe that he's stated he's looked at other sites, but he's primarily looking at this one and to see if the commission would be receptive to allowing the mini storage using a gate in this on this property because it's on a gateway. So the change to do a future zoning code amendment. He's also looking at other possible sites in the city, but I don't know what those other sites are. He may have the information on those, but those may also be in gateways as well. So I think he's just primarily seeing what the Planning Commission view would be on amending.
Yeah, and I think it best because the applicant could probably better answer that than staff. So if sure. That could be held because, we can't really answer what due diligence he's done. Sorry.
Sure. Well,
Tom, to interrupt, but I think the applicant is here, so.
Right, but in terms of the, right. Sometimes you don't hold all your cards, but in terms of the cards that they have played with the city, you're answering that there hasn't been.
Well, he's primarily looking at this site.
Got it. So. Thank you. And along the same vein, in terms of sites, and maybe this particular site, can you remember in recent memory whether there has been other potential applicants or other folks looking at this particular site or? For development?
It was Lamar Brothers Tires many years ago. We were looking at this site or somewhere around this area. I think actually they may have gotten an approval, but that fell through because I think as the economy, this was about maybe 10 years ago.
Got it. Okay. So there has been some bites in the not too distant past. Got it. Thank you. Finally, one of my sticky points that I have brought up before for storage units, it was brought to our attention at the last hearing regarding a storage facility that there was a huge need in the community for more storage facilities, which is different than the genesis for having a higher requirement for this particular activity, needing the 5.2 threshold, et cetera. Has there been additional data regarding the demand for this presented to the city?
I am not aware of any additional data as far as demand for mini storage uses here in the city. Is from real estate data, I'm not aware of any.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions for staff?
How large is this in acreage is this piece of property?
Let me see if I have a property report. Here we go. It is estimated to be around 4.25 acres.
And I'm still a little bit confused about the orientation. From the picture that you have here, if we're looking at Work Street, Sanborn would be toward the bottom of this photo.
Can you get the slide, please, on the...
It's on the background slide.
Right. So you get off the freeway and you go down what?
Go back one more.
You go right down Work, right?
Yeah.
Right. Make it right. Yeah. That quarter. Yeah, okay. It's the first right. Yeah. So you come.
Yeah, the
so
one
you get off the freeway and you come up. Okay. Got it.
Big area. Mm-hmm. And what's funny behind it, there is a ready storage area. And they kind of know where to get.
Oh, okay.
It's near the pilot. It's
wrong one. Yeah.
You need to get the one previous.
It's a better picture.
Yeah, actually, I need to get this.
It back better two maps. More.
Maybe map. Let's do a map quest.
Okay, a better question is. What is this facility right here? And then I'll have an idea of where we are. Right here.
Is it the, I think it might.
If I could try to show on the map, I believe it's right here.
I think it's New Star Ag.
It's what?
New Star.
New Star Ag.
Ag processing, New Star.
Oh. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Any other questions? John?
No, I'll swear that.
Other questions for staff? Thomas, I do have a quick question. I guess I'm hearing there's a need for storage space, and I'm assuming the applicant will address that. But there's also a need for industrial, and there's a need for commercial. And have we looked at, I think Matt kind of alluded to it, have we done any use studies and interest-based studies on that area? I mean, we had somebody, it sounds like, look at it for tires, but that was during the recession. I mean, since then, since the economy has improved, has anyone else?
I mean, like any real estate data studies or anything for?
Maybe, yeah.
Yeah, I'm not aware of any with current planning. So, as far as what's needed, as far as industrial land and land for commercial uses and residential, et cetera. I'm not aware of any right now.
And future planning, we're not looking ahead?
I could.
So the city has done some in target areas. Most recently, we've done target market studies for downtown LSL and Chinatown. Chinatown, we started looking at commercial opportunities, and we're doing the same in the LSL and also in the LSL marketplace. There is a need for many of these uses, but I don't know if this property is in that vein, although I do see it's in a flood overlay. But our biggest challenge tends to be the property itself. It's a brownfield, it's in a flood zone, it's the access points are tricky because you have to have a certain level of fire access. So just knowing, we've done a lot of, particularly in housing development, as you can imagine, we're always looking for affordable housing locations. It just seems like there are challenges with a particular piece of land that, although it looks good, once you get in kind of the nitty gritty, there's some challenges with it. So,
thank you, Rick.
Yeah, bring you up to date. I went out there, and I think you're right, Jill. It's a great site. It's big, and it could hold most any type of business, regardless what it is. However, you have to look at the geographic area, and what you have is Pilot there with all those tractor trailer trucks. Then you have Peterbilt on the other end of it. Yet at the same time, the city has come in and they're putting in brand new blacktop streets, sewers, and so forth, adjacent to the highway, going to the highway, going south. Okay, all that is being done. Sidewalks are being put in. And it's adjacent to the city-owned properties, and they got a dump site out there in the city where they dump a landfill and everything. They're adjacent to the other side of the street. When you come in on this street off of Works, okay, across the street are all commercial or industrial section. You're right there. Okay, that's there. This would be prime, but then it's being shrunk because the usage would only be in the automotive section. So when I heard about the tire company, that would have been great, and times have changed, but still would be a need because it's all automotive, highway, and so forth. So you're absolutely correct. And by the way, right behind this project is an existing storage facility. Yep, and I was there and talked to the people, and they were busy, and they said, well, I says, were you aware that something like this may come about? They says, no, we don't know anything about it, but if one went in, it would impact our business.
Thank you. Okay. Any other questions of staff? Then I would like to invite the applicant to come forward and make a statement and be willing to answer questions.
Yeah, said.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for my time. My name is Brad Slama. First, I'd like to say thank you twice over. First to staff, Ms. Hunter, Mr. Grossman, and Mr. Wiles. They're very receptive. We do a lot of development here in town. We have a lot of projects And it's very nice to have a great staff that's willing to hear all of our concerns with zonings and other things that come up on each of these particular lots. It's never simple. It's never easy. The easy ones have already been done. They're finished throughout the city. So we're very thankful for the great staff that we have. Secondly, last time I was here, I didn't get a chance to say thank you for agreeing to amend the code with a 3-bedroom and 4-bedroom mix. I can say that that project is going forward. We're going to start here in November. We'll finish in March, and we'll have 16 more studio units to add to the quantity. Two of those will be very low income, $600 a unit. There'll be some people that are very thankful for that decision, and the only reason that happened is because of your willingness to allow the change. Storage, the reason we're here. Right now, we're all somewhat aware of the imbalance of storage and the need for it in the city. The last time a developer from out of town was here, he alluded to some of the numbers. We've done our own numbers. We own a storage facility down in Greenfield. We're very familiar. The national average price per square foot is about 85 cents. The average in Salinas is $1.75. From my numbers, the way that we build, when you talk about land costs and construction, a feasible mini storage can survive constructing today at $1 a square foot of residual income revenue. So at $1.75, the consumers are the ones that are paying for this. The reason that we've gotten to this point could be blamed all every direction. But you know, at $1, we'd be a lot better off. At $1.75, 1,000 square feet, that's $1,750. That's the same price people are paying for apartments. That's the same thing they're paying for residential. And this stuff is not that expensive to build. When I look at the code, after we had the gentleman come in and talk about the Pepsi plant, and the commission was amicable to this, we looked high and low. We looked at every single property in the city. We're hungry to provide a couple hundred thousand square feet of this. The city really needs about 500,000 more to level off and get the price point down where it should be. We looked everywhere. There's not very many places left. It's very difficult. Every time we looked at something, Gateway, 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 Gateway. And right now in the Gateway, you have an industrial business park, IGC, IG, and CR that all allow warehouse and mini storage subject to a conditional use permit. And we like that process. We like the fact that the public gets to say every time we want to do one of these. But then in the Gateway, under all four of those locations, it says not permitted, not permitted, not permitted, not permitted. My question today is why. My assumption is that it's been an aesthetic thing, that when we look at the entries to the city, we don't want to see rows and rows of storages and a little tiny shack in front that's, you know, the unit. I put a picture for you today to show that things are changing when it comes to an aesthetic. There are ways that we can dress these up. That's not the picture, but that'll work. You guys have a picture in front of you that shows what they can look like. And yes, correct, thank you. What I'm asking for is the opportunity to present a product that you can say, yeah, this looks great, this will look great, if that's the concern from the Gateway standpoint. One, we can alleviate the concern depth that we have of inventory. We can provide more supply, and in so doing, we can do something really nice. So I'm asking for the opportunity to maybe change this to a CUP across the board so that we can present projects. You know, give us the opportunity to show you, hey, this is what we can do. Let's put an asterisk next to it and say, hey, it's in the Gateway. You have to go above and beyond. Go the extra mile. We can build these buildings that look like commercial office buildings, but actually are our full indoor storages. They don't look like our typical row storage. So I'm just asking for some flexibility and some openness. We do a lot of different development, residential, industrial, warehouse, commercial, office, the whole nine yards. So any questions that you have about the current market, I'm a pretty good judgment of that. I can help you out where you can. And I'd love to hear your questions and comments and concerns to find out if we can move forward with this.
Thank you,
Mr. Slama.
Can you
explain these pictures real quick?
Yes, please. Okay, so this is the Gateway District up at North Main, where North Main meets. I don't remember which number it is. I think it's number one. So that's where the new US 101 that basically went over Espinosa now and creates essentially a block from the entrance where it might have used to have been. If you slide one or two pictures up, you'll see this is the preliminary entrance to the top of the gateway at North Main. You got a dilapidated piece of property, go one more, you've got just blank land. This is zone CR. This is something we could look at, that we could present to the commission and say, hey, you know, we've made a deal with the property owner. We'd like to present this as an option. Here's the design. Here's what we want to do. And then have the discussion about that individual parcel. This is the kind of thing we're seeing across the gateway. The reason we brought this one in today at 851 Work Street is because it's an extremely difficult, challenging site to build out from a development standpoint. If a specific end user came in, like a Lamar Brothers, like another type that actually had a permit pulled a couple of years ago, I don't remember the brand name, they can cookie cutter it up for their perfect thing. We are speculative developers. We do design builds for tenants. This property, even though it's 4.45 acres, would only yield about 40,000 square feet of industrial, traditional tilt up, which is what we do, which is less than an acre. You know, your standard floor area ratio that you would want in an IG or an IGC area is at least 40%, if not 50. So in this particular lot, and the reason I brought this as an example, I'm not saying that this is the place we have to do it, but this is the example that we have on the table, is that we could do 80,000 square feet of storage here, but we could only do 40,000 of industrial tilt-up. So if we're trying to meet the numbers and supply the need to the consumers, let's do it in a place where we have an opportunity to do more versus less. The restrictions on the site are the irrigation or the reclamation ditch. There's also, that you can't see, there's two easements running through it, one for a pipeline and the other for PG&E. So there's a box around this, plus the configuration. You see how that triangle dips in? It makes it very difficult to site map. And so that's why I've kind of brought that. So we would like to propose a two or even three story warehouse facility there, completely indoors. And get away from that row section that you're used to seeing, and that's what we want to be able to kind of present and have a conversation about.
Great, thank you. Questions from the commissioners?
Currently, based on that map and where he wants to put that building, that road is already dug, paved, and ready to go for final pouring. As you go on down, correct. As you come in off of Works, make correct. A right-hand turn, all of that is ready to go for a brand new street with sidewalks and et cetera all the way down. Correct. And on your left, you got the city that has its dump yard over there. And they're taking that fill from down below, bringing it up and moving it over. And I don't know if that has anything to do with the fact we talked about a floodplain. Who knows? Or, you know. But that's what I saw when I went out there to check it all out. And I don't see any problem for any other type of commercial establishment going out there. Ample water, ample transportation to and from Main Street, going all the way across with Sanborn, major thoroughfare. There's a light right there where you can turn and get on there. Away from Pilot, the gas station there, if you jog your memory, that's where it's located. And then across the street, as you're going north, there's all industrial buildings all in through there. So it's a mini industrial park.
Other questions for the applicant?
Quick question. I just wanted to make sure I understood correctly. So thank you, Mr. Slama, for joining us today and providing this opportunity to look at and provide some feedback, because that's what you're asking for. I appreciate that. You mentioned demand, and you expressed that based on your per square foot cost that you could bring this in at versus what else is out there on the market, that you would be successful in that, that the project would be successful, but to me that doesn't necessarily address the issue of excess demand in the marketplace. That's just saying that that's not saying that you're not gonna pull from other storage facilities.
Correct.
So I just wanted to ask if do you have any data that addresses the question of market demand for storage facilities in Salinas?
Okay, so when we do our analysis, we don't go out to outside consultants and try to get a full report of a regional area. That it's not a commonplace in the warehouse industry. Most of what happens is, you know, phone calls to warehouses, or like Mr. Giffen did, you go down and you talk to him and say, hey, what are you charging? How many units do you have available? And if you find out from these guys, we don't have very many available and we're charging a lot. And the reason they're charging a lot is because the demand's high and the supply's low. So they're able to charge a lot for those, you know, when a unit does come available, they're able to raise it. Just like same thing's happening in residential right now. You know, you get a unit available, you put it out there, you're getting 20 people calling, so what do? You raise the price. The price goes up because the demand's so high. So what we do is we look at it and say, okay, if the price is at 175, but we believe it should be at 100 for a 10 by 10 unit, we sit there and say, okay, well, how many square feet are there in Salinas? There's 600 and some odd thousand square feet of storage in Salinas. If we impacted and added 100,000, what would that do? It could, for the most part, it could take 10% from here and here and here, from all these locations. Or there might be people that have been on the fence that want storage but aren't willing to pay that 175. So if we come out and list it at 100 or 125 to try to capitalize on the market, then maybe we get new people and some people will move over. The argument is, you know, because gas is $150 a barrel, these guys that have been producing it there for 30 years at $10 a barrel, they're making a killing. All of a sudden, you know, new supplies come online, new technologies come online, fracking, and now the price is back down to 50. Is that wrong? I don't necessarily think that that's equitable. I believe that the people that currently have storages in the area, and we have one too, are making really good money and almost robbing. Because they can, because the demand's high.
Right, but that's the issue. It's not the issue that that storage units aren't available, because essentially what's before us is the option, okay, to permanently utilize a piece of property that is properly zoned, hard to come by in the city. Industrial might be the most difficult thing in our whole city to zone for, to not have everybody complain about. We have a site here that works for us, that works for the community, and is baked into the general plan. And the proposal is to change that. So I'm struggling to get there based on the sustainability of a business. Great, that's important. But that doesn't get me over the hump of carving out in for forever this piece of property that's supposed to be available for an industrial activity. And so part of my question too, and maybe you answered this or have the answer, if staff can join as well, is when we look at the site, and I totally understand the constraints and, you know, the remainder parcel that you have after dealing with all the constraints, the nature of the site, can somebody clarify, either you or the city, whether the adjacent property, which is also vacant, which I assume is also zoned industrial?
I can verify.
Is it possible for those two sites to be combined at some point in the future?
There is a PG&E easement running direct through it, a high voltage line that splits it, and a 25-foot easement that runs through it. So there's no potential to be able to do any development that would cross over that. But backing up to your original point about IG, I would prefer the city take a stance and say, hey, we're not going to allow storage in IG at all. My conundrum is, why is it a CUP in IG where it's not a gateway, but it's not permitted in a gateway? That doesn't change the balance. So if protecting industrial general land is the goal, let's do it. And let's remove it from the option table in industrial zone areas. My focus is the gateway. Why are we protecting the gateway as opposed to the regular stuff, the regular IG that's not in the gateway, the regular IGC that's not in the gateway, the CR that's not in the gateway? There's, you know, the location we just showed up on the north side of town, on North Main, that is, you know, dilapidated property. If that's a CUP option, I'd like to bring that forward too. I'm not just focusing on one parcel. I'd like to be able to go broad scope over on West Market. There's a couple buildings that are prime for, you know, that look old and tired, that need a revitalization similar to the PepsiCo plant. But we can't even bring it forward because it's not permitted. I would love to bring, say I brought 851 forward and you said, hey, we just don't want to give up the industrial general land. I'm okay with that. I would be fine with that. But let me take a crack at some other spots and say, hey, what do you think about this location and this location?
Got it. No, I appreciate that. And to answer that specifically, I would be willing to entertain those project-specific, idea-specific land use designation discussions. Sure. On this one, okay, again, talking about the merits of this particular case, these two sites, again, as I've been party to development where you had this constraint of a PG&E line, and I had a 5-acre site, and I had a PG&E line running through the middle. So you have to deal with the setback issue, and you deal with your structures, and you work with the agencies to make sure that the setbacks are there, and you develop your site. So obviously you have to deal with those constraints. But so my question is that could somebody come along, purchase both of these sites, deal with that constraint as a single combined parcel?
So Mr. Slama, if you could just wait 1 second, I'm gonna ask Megan to respond.
Please.
Yeah, and I want to try to give a little bit of context. We're really focusing kind of on the details of the site, but the question really is whether or not this planning commission would be amenable to removing the not permitted from either, it can be from the gateways altogether or from the IG gateway specifically. And would still require a CUP. So whatever the applicant would propose, because this is hypothetical, it may not even be at this site, then they still would have to make you comfortable with, you know, could you combine sites? What could happen? But the overall question is, in the IG, we do allow mini storage, but we don't allow it in the gateway. Is it, we want to keep that because we just think it doesn't belong in the gateway, or, you know, could it be allowed in the gateway with design or development restrictions? I think that's the question. So so I just want to focus on that because I feel like we're asking a lot of site-specific questions, but we're really just talking about a code amendment.
Got it. And to address that, I kind of answered that before, is that I would be interested in having that discussion based on a per project basis. So if it's the right project coming down the street, and if this is one of the first things I saw versus some other things I see right now on Market or on Sanborn or on half of the other streets you get off the freeway, I'm satisfied with that. However, that needs to be balanced with protecting the interests of trying to convert the industrial properties that we have. So based on everything I know right now, I'm not liking it here at this site.
I appreciate that. Thank you. That's helpful information as well. I mean, yes, focus on the one, but I like getting that as well.
And just one thing I wanted to add is one thing you could consider too, because it sounds like we're getting a little bit into the marketing question. You know, for the economic development incentive, we actually require a kind of a third party person to do some analysis before the city council considers offering an economic incentive. So that could be something that is required through the CUP process, that you would want some kind of analysis if you're struggling with what are the economic impacts of allowing for mini storage. So I just throw that out.
Yes, Rick.
This question is for Megan. Megan, when you talk about the gateway and what's permissible or not, then how did that other storage unit, which is adjacent to this property, get approved?
It's not in the gateway.
It's only a block away, so it's out of the gateway?
I think it's out of the gateway. Or no, maybe it predated.
It's in the gateway, but it predates.
Yeah.
Okay, because you had to be confused when you said, you know, this is...
And we got one right here. I'm saying, whoa.
And I would actually, I think it would be helpful if Courtney gave a little bit of context about why the storage came up, why this these storage restrictions came up.
Some time ago, there were a number of storage operators that approached the city, and I believe it's the city council where ultimately the discussion took place. But there was a moratorium put in place because the mini storage proprietors were indicating a loss of revenue due to an overglut, and the supply was far, you know, greater than the demand. There were some concerns with that. The city studied the issue during the time of the moratorium. New rules were established, which is typical during a moratorium. The new rules, I think, were more or less touched on earlier. There's a super majority vote of the commission that's required. The administrative capabilities of the city planner are completely removed, so they must go to the planning commission. And if the certain vote does not occur, then it automatically goes to the city council as a final decision maker. This happened back in a time when there was apparently an over supply. Does that cover the details enough?
Thank you, Courtney. Are there any other questions? I'm just looking at the time, so are there any other questions of the applicant? Okay, so what I'd like to do is open it to the public, and then we're going to come back and let the commissioners make recommendations to you, Mr. Slama. I'd like to open a public hearing. Is there anyone who would like to speak to this issue? Okay, seeing no movement, I'm going to bring it back to the commission, and I'm going to ask if anybody's interested in providing Mr. Slama with direction, recommendations. John, are you?
So what you're telling us is that if this is rezoned and you build this facility, it's going to look like this.
Yes, you're welcome.
I wouldn't say exactly like that, but I would like to present something similar to that. And I would like that to be the architectural standard in the gateway wide. To okay. Say, hey, if you bring us something like this.
So it'd be all internal storage, no RVs on the lot and stuff like that?
Potentially, if that's the restriction we want to develop within the gateway, allowing, yes.
Okay, it's possible. Thank you.
George, do you have any comments?
And I like that picture, and I think it's acceptable for the gateway. And the one thing I do like want to share is that, you know, in my business, we use storage quite a bit. And we can't get it. We're offering extra incentives just to get other space. So, it's pretty full everywhere we go. Wow. It's not available. So we're struggling for a space for the school district.
Thank you. Do you have any comments, questions?
Yes, Commissioner Griffin has a comment.
I'm sorry.
No worries. So my comment is, I'm certain that city council was well-intentioned years ago when they put a moratorium on mini storage because there was an oversupply. But what we've seen here is by putting our thumb on the scale of the free market, we have created a situation where spaces that we might prefer stay commercial and IG for other development are now highly valuable in mini storage because we have artificially impacted the free market. So my sense is that if we take our thumb off the scale, the free market does a very good job of deciding what should go where and who will profit and who will lose. This is a great case where these current vendors are and mini storage suppliers are doing very well for themselves at the expense of our citizens, and we need to take a step back and let entrepreneurs fill that void and balance the market again. And then I think we'll be looking at a situation where this prime industrial space then won't be as valuable for mini storage in the future.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner, no comments?
I move that we go for a vote.
We're not voting on this
right,
item.
I know. Yeah.
Okay, and Commissioner Huerta?
I think I've provided my comments before. Thank you.
And just for history, one of the things that the council had considered, it wasn't just the glut on the market, it was the fact that when you put in a mini storage, you also lose out on that industrial opportunity or commercial opportunity. It's not income to the city, and it creates spaces that are not walkable. So be it, that's in the past. I think that it's very clear, people like the design restrictions that we're talking about, and the idea of a CUP where we can have the discussion. So unless, if anyone has any other comments that they'd like to provide, then I'm going to move on. Thank you, Mr. Slama, for coming.
I did want to ask one question for clarification. Is, you know, there's two kind of options on the table. One is possibly a code amendment that just specific to the IG. One would be the gateway, the other zones within the industrial zones in the gateway where it's located. And just for our purposes, were your comments for all zones or just the IG zone, if that makes sense?
Yeah, that brings me to the question I kind of have. Is it possible that this be looked at on a case-by-case basis? In other words, this particular one, if approved, if somebody else wants to do the same thing, they got to come back and go through the program. Yeah.
So if we do remove the not permitted from the gateway, whether it would require them to, for you to review it on a case-by-case basis.
Yeah, in other words, could it be done for this one specific area and not affect all of the...
No, the only way we could do that is to amend the gateway boundaries, which I think we mentioned we're not interested. We would amend the code. It could be limited to a particular zone. Like, it could be just the IG zone only, but it couldn't be to, like, a particular parcel.
Okay. If the commission determines that gateways deserve a higher architecture, then there could be some plugged-in special requirements for this gateway. Keep in mind, gateways were are basically created through the 2002 general plan, and they wanted to look at bringing it up a notch in terms of inappropriate uses and design standards. So that would be in accord with that gateway program.
So I guess my only question is, the code amendment, would it be applied to all gateways that would allow storage through CUP or just specific industrial districts? We have the IG, the IGC, the CR. I don't know if anyone has a thought on that, if their comments apply to all of the zones that would allow it. So in other words, we'd remove the use restrictions on the gateway, but still require the CUP or...
Megan, my question is, if we have it on the books, why? And if it's not logical or applicable in today's venue of business, then we need a change.
And I understand why it's there, because of the look, the need, and to make our city attractive, and it makes sense. But like with something like this, I mean, we tend to, we see storage units as not attracting when you first come in, but then you get something like this with architecturally, it does look appeasing. And like what Matt says, it's, you come down a few of these streets, this would be very nice to have there compared to what we have there now. But to change what they have in place, there's a reason why it's there, and it has its purpose. To come back to what John's saying, is there a way we could look at individual requests that come up? Because like, he really modified this to make it look appeasing for me to say, yes, let this in. But I don't want to open it up, and now we have the warehouse effect looking, coming into areas I wouldn't want them in. But you know, so how do we put this as we would like to see more effort and to where it fits the requirements we would like in those areas. Not necessarily the stop the business, but how they bring it in, what it looks like. Does that make sense, I think?
Yeah, so I think, and Courtney mentioned, we can look at some development standards. And then the other thing, it seemed like there was some interest in having some market analysis as well, that would be helpful, which is something we have done in the past. So if that is of interest, that's something we could do.
Question.
Any questions?
Another question.
Yes, please.
Maybe staff can help just quickly explain the difference between what, you know, the timing and the general cost associated with processing a zoning code amendment versus not having to do that. Because that's really what you're asking for. You're asking us to not have the applicant move forward on a proposed project without having to go through a zoning code amendment.
Well, I think a little clarity on that. The applicant can't move forward now. It's not allowed. Mini storage in gateways throughout the entire span of all the gateways is a prohibited use.
So we would need to do a zoning code amendment in order to allow for that.
Correct. And that's the question that the applicant wants to know. Is it worth spending his money on a code amendment only to get turned down?
I guess that's what I'm saying, though, is what their money to ask the city to do a code amendment that would open that up for anybody, mm-hmm. right? Are there other code amendments that we can wrap into that?
If introduced.
Right.
Well, so city staff constantly maintains a list of code amendments, and the commission has seen, and the council has seen,
some cleanups
over the years, cleanup items.
Right.
This is not necessarily a cleanup item.
Right.
This is a policy shift.
It'd be very specific. So I guess part of my thing is, and if they're, it was mentioned earlier that, you know, this kind of proposal or activity could be very lucrative. So it's unlike some other things where it's kind of, okay, we break even, hey, we'll be lucky if we break even type of thing. So I guess my point on saying that is that, hey, if a project is good enough, big enough, looks nice enough, propose that and go through the process of the zoning code amendment, and it'll stand, and the merits will stand on its own.
Yeah, he can't, we can't do that. It has to, you have to enable it. What Courtney is saying is you have to enable it in the code before we can even. Step one is code amendment, then step two would be, and if it was done, it would still come to the commission. It would be a conditional use permit. There would be a hearing, but we have to do step one first.
We can process those two together concurrently. In fact, the code says to do so. So you'd have the conditional use permit in connection with the code amendment. The CUP would not be effective until...
Right. I guess that's how I think I've seen it before where we've done that. So I guess that's why I was confused. And I get that's part of what this hearing, though, is it worth all that effort? And I get that.
Well, I think...
But it sounds to me like it's worth someone's effort to do that.
And I would just add, I think he's looking at multiple sites. It sounds like multiple sites that would be affected. So, before he goes down that road, he wants to make sure that this is
right.
something.
Well, it sounds like you got four or five commissioners here that are interested in looking at it. So I think that's enough feedback, candidly.
There's no guarantees what the commission says. An application still has to come forward.
Right.
Sure. I'm not opposed at all. I think this something definitely should be looked at.
So if there's no more questions and comments, Courtney, we're going to go into our study session.
Okay.
We'll be discussing a notice of preparation for the Salinas Travel Center.
Let this PowerPoint load up here. So in the past, the staff has come forward to the commission with a number of notice of preparation announcements. I think the EDD was one of them, economic development element rather, EDE. And I believe it was the Western Area Specific Plan, I think, is the one that came forward as well. There are a number of larger planning efforts that are moving forward, and we've held study sessions a couple of times with the commission to go over those projects. This is yet another one of those projects. It's called the Salinas Travel Center. This project launched a notice of preparation on October 20th, just recently. Should I say 2017? Hold on a second.
No, probably right.
Yeah, I guess it is right. There is a year already. Yeah, I guess so. So I can't believe how time flies. So this project landed in the city in 2016. The notice of preparation went out, and that basically signals to agencies that the city of Salinas has received a project. It will require preparation of an environmental impact report. A number of issues were identified in the initial study. A list of those issues were listed in the actual notice of preparation. Some of those issues included aesthetics, agricultural resources, air quality, hydrology, land use, noise, public services, utilities. There actually are probably more issues that are going to ultimately be addressed in the preparation of the environmental impact report. But this gives the agencies an opportunity to communicate with the city and assist in scoping or identifying what to address in the EIR. So in this particular case, we held a scoping meeting on the 17th of November. I think attendance was fairly low, probably around zero actually showed up, I think, for that particular scoping meeting. But nonetheless, we compiled letters from agencies and off we went to prepare an environmental impact report. That report is underway now. An administrative draft is being reviewed. We anticipate release of that fairly soon. So this project is located east of the 101 freeway. It's kind of sandwiched there between the airport and the De La Torre area. This is the area where the freeway on-ramps were recently reconfigured with the airport, what do you call it, the airport interchange project, I guess is what Caltrans referred to it, something to that effect. The project includes a number of permits. There's annexation. 64 acres, about 30 of those acres are actually right-of-way. They're roadways and on-ramps. There's a general plan amendment. Currently, it's purple, which is an IG designation. The project includes a hotel, which I'll get into next, which required a general plan amendment from general industrial to retail. Hotels aren't allowed in the industrial zone. A pre-zoning and a rezone to do the same. A specific plan. Any annexations that come into the city known as future growth areas require preparation of a specific plan, and that is well underway with a draft document as well. There's a parcel map. There's four parcels. I'll get into that shortly, but there's two parcels on one side of the interchange and then two on the other. Two of the parcels actually have development plans for them. The other two at this time do not. A site plan review for the actual development, and that'll be an administrative process that contemplates the actual construction and the design and a master sign plan. The last three, the parcel map, the site plan review, and the master sign plan, are considered more or less administrative activities, and they won't be going to decision makers. So coming up soon, the Planning Commission will be looking at the general plan amendment, the annexation, the rezone, pre-zone, the specific plan. This is a little bit more detail. This is actually a picture of the parcel map. Parcel 1 and 2 are located up in this area. Right there is where the hotel is proposed. It's about 94 rooms. And this is the travel center. It's actually a site plan, which I'll show you next. And this is parcel 3 and parcel 4. No immediate plans for development right now. This is the site plan of parcels 1 and 2. The hotel is right here, 94 rooms. This is the 101. This is the De La Torre area. Parcel 2 is basically the travel center. It consists of truck fueling stations, automobile fueling stations, a C store, a fast food restaurant, and a mechanics building.
The remainder of this area, all these little lines, are truck storage stalls, similar to the truck stops you see along the various interstates throughout the United States. So that is your site plan. Again, there's no plans for parcels 3 and 4, but in terms of traffic analysis, the city put together a presumption or an assumption of general industrial land use at 0.5 FAR, which equates to around 390 square feet of industrial development. At the end of the day, any future projects that come in subject to site plan review or whatnot would be looked at in terms of that impact. If they go over that impact, then additional environmental review would be necessary. So this NOP, it has been prepared. The environmental impact report is underway. It should be coming to commission in the near future. We want to kind of keep you informed of the various significant projects. This is one of them.
Thank you, Courtney. Any questions? This is just a study session.
Courtney, where's this property located?
Excuse me?
Where is this property located?
This is the Salinas Airport. This okay. is the 101. It's more or less the southern area of the city. This is Airport Boulevard Interchange.
Okay, I know where that's at.
Jack in the Box and Denny's, I think, is over here.
So you're coming back into the city, all right.
It's the southern industrial side of the city. It's currently ag land.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Question?
Are there any issues with the conversion of ag land there that we should be concerned about in terms of timing or politics?
Well, the city has adopted a ag land conversion policy. The environmental impact report is not finished, and those are some of the issues that we're currently studying right now. Mitigation measures are being developed. It's an internal draft, and those policies will be converted into mitigation measures.
Site, I wasn't thinking about it till now, but the site might lend itself to being a good site for the county's safe parking program. Has that come up at all?
The county state parking program?
The county's safe, S-A-F-E, safe parking program that the county is currently looking at sites for throughout the county of Monterey. Are you guys aware of that?
I'm aware of it. Yeah.
You want to comment?
No. I mean, this is actually being driven by a proposed project that Courtney kind of described. And I think the idea is that the other sites would be developed with industrial, you know, whatever is compatible in the IG. So I think they anticipate development would happen fast, and certainly parcels 1 and 2, where we already have a project specifically that we're looking at and that's built into the specific plan.
You're talking about for the safe parking program? Or are you talking about
I'm talking about, this is project-driven, a project.
This is a specific project?
Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah. Parcels 1 and 2 are fairly well-defined.
Yeah.
Got it. Okay.
Parcels 3 and 4 are even, you know, there's, I think they have some thinking about what they would do there.
Okay. So my point in mentioning the safe parking program is also to ask, because the idea is, again, we're being inundated here because of the quasi-closing of the Lapis Road issue with RVs, whatever, and now all of a sudden you drive around town and what do you see? In every other neighborhood, wherever they can, people are parking because they can't be on Lapis Road anymore. Other cities hopefully are starting to step up, but I'm curious in terms of, you know, again, it doesn't have to be this site, but new sites lend themselves, if we plan correctly for them, then all the issues associated with existing sites go away because the existing sites have their limitations. But if we're talking about new sites, maybe there's an opportunity to get ahead of some of the design issues and planning issues associated with a safe parking site, whether that's supporting bathrooms,
supporting a program, working with the existing owners or the tenants as they know what they're getting into in terms of citing that kind of program. So is there something that the city is looking at now in terms of existing industrial sites or commercial sites for a safe parking program?
Not really industrial sites. I'd be hesitant to put any people living in areas and industrial areas because, as Courtney pointed out to me when I first got here, there's a lot of food processing and they use ammonia, and that's why they have those wind socks. And if there's ever a catastrophic failure of those, and we have a lot of residential in industrial areas, it could be really problematic. But we are looking at housing solutions, housing options for the homeless. And I think, you know, so we could come back and talk about that at another time.
Right. So again, this is a travel, Salinas Travel Center. It's transient. It's not industrial. So it's a transient already center for people that are coming and going. So, and that's the nature of a safe parking program, that folks aren't going to be there permanently. They're coming and going. And so I'm just putting that out there. I understand your frustration. I understand your hesitancy to loop that into this. I just want to push the envelope on that discussion because that condition is not going away anywhere, and it's getting pushed into our neighborhoods, and we can't just not do nothing.
So, Matt, maybe I could suggest that be a future agenda item, and we can talk about maybe even merging with the county program or at least having a discussion.
Sure.
Because I think that is something important that should come from the Planning Commission. Okay. All right. Thank you, Courtney. Anything else?
Certainly.
Okay. I'd like to move to future agenda items, and I'm going to look to you, Matt, to make your comments on the two public requests.
Yeah, just quickly, the one comment first was from Mr. Rocha, and he's still with us. Thank you, sir. Wow, he's a patient guy right there, man. That guy's glutton for punishment. Is this a study thing for you? It's for work, for school? Must be, huh? No. All right, man. So he mentioned the CUP license, or CUP had not come forward here, I guess, and that was, I understand, approved on a consent basis by the city council. Is that right? For which cinema? Okay, maybe the staff. So maybe we start with staff in terms of clarifying what was approved by council for the CUP in question.
I'm prepared to provide a response, but I'm not sure if that's normally how this type of question is processed. I don't want to step on any policies on dissemination of information through a public comment. If it's deemed appropriate, I'll provide.
I'm not sure what your hesitation is. Can you help clarify that for me?
I think it's a Brown Act question. If we give you the information, are we, you know, stepping on the Brown Act?
Yeah, my understanding was that Courtney was going to provide, or staff would look into it and provide some sort of written response in response to Chairperson Lutz's request of staff. And that way we don't get too far off of the agendized topics. I thought moving this to future agenda items that there was either questions or further direction of staff on the comment made by Mr. Rocha, and we wanted to make sure you had an opportunity to say those things and provide staff that information or guidance.
So in order to provide some guidance, I'm asking a question as to what clarification of a informational item here, and the informational item is, can you tell us what the council approved? Why can't you tell us what the council approved?
I think we're just questioning, can we discuss this, something, a topic off agenda for the Brown Act? I will say that I already prepared a memo to city council members regarding this issue specifically, and I have no problem providing it to Jordan, and she could forward it to you, but I think we're deferring to Anais if we can provide the information, we will, but I don't want to get into a Brown Act issue.
Yeah, the only limitation, Commissioner Huerta, is that we do need to stay on the published agenda, and so we open up for public comment for the opportunity for the commission to hear from the public. However, delving too far deep into those comments would run the risk that we're discussing matters that should be properly agendized. If you are, so for instance, and the reason that we do that is if there was anyone who wanted to participate in the conversation about what Mr. Rocha talked about, the alcohol CUP, that they would know to be here today or to tune in on the computer or online. So that way we just sort of give everyone an opportunity who wants to weigh in to be able to weigh in and participate in this conversation. So I think what makes sense to me is for the memo that Megan referenced to be circulated to the commissioners, and if the commission does want to have further conversation about that, perhaps we can bring it back for properly agendized item, and that way everyone who, any stakeholders, anyone else who'd like to participate in that conversation is invited and aware of that conversation. That's, I think, where staff is sort of cautiously moving this forward with the commission's direction, if I hear you correctly, Courtney.
That's my understanding. I think a future, or what we call follow-up reports, might be an appropriate place for that.
And I think it certainly is an appropriate place for it. I think, though, that Matt's question is, can you please let us know what was the issue that Anthony was referring to? What was the decision made by council? That certainly can't be a violation of the Brown Act. We just want clarification on what was asked by a public member, and then we'd like to have that as a future agenda item.
What Anthony is referring to is actually a administrative conditional use permit that actually did not go to City Council, but as you know, we do have that alcohol admin CUP process that you notify individuals within a 300-foot radius, and if there's no written protest, then it's actually approved. So that's a process that it followed for the theater at the Northridge Mall. This, I think it's called the Century Theaters officially. I think that's their name.
So,
and it's beer and wine only. I forgot to say that.
So I would like to get the response from staff. And let me tell you that I got a call from a city council member who was very unhappy and wanted to know why it didn't come to the Planning Commission, and I had no idea. So if we could get that and be included in that discussion, John?
I don't see any reason why we can't go ahead and request that this be put on the agenda for the future.
But
now, instead of coming back later and say, yeah, we'd like to look at that in the future.
Okay, good. So let's have that as a future agenda item. Thank you, Matt. Did you want to comment on Dominic Durso with the study sessions?
Sure. Okay. Thank you for that, everybody. And on Mr. Durso's comments around having more community engagement, opportunity for the community to hear and learn about Planning Commission items, essentially before they come up, seems like a novel idea, and just having opportunity, space carved out in time for discussion or issues in terms of study sessions. I think, thank you, staff, you have been better around about that, and I think part of it's clearing some of the issues off your plate over the recent months and the year. I think we've had more study sessions this year than I can remember. So that should be applauded, and I think we just want to be a little continue to be strategic about those study sessions. And maybe I want to put out there for discussion, does it make sense to do some community engagement from the Planning Commission's perspective in terms of using, let's say, the city website to have kind of an ongoing request out there to the community? Hey, what kind of study sessions, what do you want to learn about from a planning perspective in town? Here's the list, here's a general plan, here's a housing element, here's the economic development element, here's all these specific plans coming up. Yes, they will have their own things going on, but is there, is there something in terms of interest from the community that folks want to know more about? It was clear that Mr. Durst is talking about housing and affordable housing and the affordable housing ordinance. How is that really going to work out? Some people participated, others weren't. Some people, even the ones that participated, didn't know what the heck was going on. So it's like, just depends. But I want to put that out there instead of us thinking what the community wants and desires to learn about. Why don't we hear from them before we take too much action on that? Maybe we put it out there somehow in terms of identifying what kind of study sessions the community wants to know more about, and that way, and then we plan accordingly and have it dovetail with other action items. Since we're gonna meet and you guys are all spending your precious time already to have a meeting, we can have another a half hour to an hour study session on a particular topic.
Yeah, that's fine. There's a couple ways for folks to communicate with staff. Obviously, there's the public comments. There's letters, there's emails. The city's website has a current planning portal, which allows correspondence to flow into the office. And I think there may be some other things. I'm not sure if we're doing on social media just yet. I think we're starting to embark in that area.
Yes.
Appreciate that.
We can explore and maybe put that as a follow-up agenda item and be prepared to talk a little bit more about, you know, the feedback and what we think we could do.
So. Appreciate that. And, you know, so even flyers or something that gets out there on social media that we can then share, I think it's just, it's problematic or almost inappropriate for us to feel like we're, you know, like we're out there advocating for something to come before us. You know what I mean? But it behooves us, right, to, so it's kind of like, how does that really work? And we're really, I guess we're reaching out to staff at this point, and we've heard from the public now that they want that kind of interaction. Everyone's trying to figure out, how does that really work? And it can't really come from one of us or all of us as a body, because we have to be removed from that. So we need staff to take leadership on that, and we can help along the way, provide ideas, but we really need staff's leadership on that.
I think we did have some sort of a presentation on inclusionary housing a little while ago, prior to the inclusionary housing ordinance coming before the commission. We could take a look at that, polish it off, bring it back in for another look.
And I would argue that, yeah, it's inappropriate for a planning commission to get involved with individual cases. And so I would, you know, be cognizant of that. But in terms of like the general plan update or the Alice, I mean, these are kind of community-wide planning initiatives that are city-led, and we really need the Planning Commission to take a lead and to get involved and get people there. So we would like to see you be more active in those efforts, and we would like to create a place for that for you. So we'll think about it, and maybe we could talk, because we'd like your feedback too in that discussion.
I have a recommendation. Number one, we have a city council, okay? And what are they there for? They're representing the people in their district. And in that district are all these problems that are coming up. I don't think this body here should be sitting here pushing certain agendas. Our duty and responsibility is what comes out of the planning department and the growth and where the city is going. Not to get involved in a whole lot of social issues on the side, and not to have members who are housing advocates to come into meetings and to constantly bring up in a sly way or sideways things about housing and so forth, when to a point they're not applicable to what we're supposed to be doing. And I want us to get back to the primary.
Are there any other comments before we close?
I did have a couple other future agenda items, however. Yes. And I'm hearing we'll bring forward something about alcohol processing in the city of Salinas, and some sort of a study session on housing. But looking at future
and I think also outreach. Discussion about outreach and community engagement in planning efforts.
Good.
Got it. In terms of other projects, November 1, we have a slot reserved for another study session, indeed, overview of significant projects. It was labeled as an option.
So I'm not sure if we'll take that one or not. As we get closer to that, we'll have to make some decisions on that meeting. That's November 1. November 15, I have EDD and FEIR. I'm not sure if that is still holding.
Yes, actually, there needs to be a recommendation at that meeting for the EDE. And so, yes, for sure. Good.
Then I think we have a library project coming forward eventually. It was on that meeting. It might have slipped a little bit. And that's about it in terms of specific dates.
Good. Thank you, Courtney. Let me just check real quickly. Will everybody be available November 1st, as far as you know?
If I'm breathing.
Thank you, John. Let's sign November 1st. Okay. And November 15th, just in case. Get both of those too. Good. Well, then, unless there's anything else anyone wants to say, I will call this meeting adjourned. It's 5:45. Thank you. Thank you for coming.
Thanks.